wood shop on one side and the small house on the other side. Just a little bit.
Oh, I forget.
I know.
fill out those index cards that you see. So if we can have somebody tracing, we'll have that information. If you have any Joyce concerns, fill out a Joyce concerns card and put it back. Oh, that's good for good news. Sue Whitman sent out Sunday school lessons to all families this week. The kids can fill out a lesson plan, and they can also use Amplified website for additional resources. So we're trying to get Sunday school going, even if it's virtual. We still want to stay in touch with our young children. The mission basket for today is Meals on Wheels. The altar flowers today, given by Bob Arnold and family in memory of Denise Giagas, mother, daughter, and granddaughter. They may be other announcements. Any birthdays or anything exciting? Nothing to say. At this time, Chair will lead us in meditation with prayer. Find that his followers are to worry their own actions and attitudes, not worry about
ever-living God, we give you thanks for who you are, for the love that you have given to us, for the care that is with us. How there is nothing we can do that can separate you from us, for your love never fails. You have given us everything we need to survive, air, food, water, the water. You know, we just know that every good and perfect gift comes from your hand. And we acknowledge that even though that is the case, we do not always do what it is you desire us to do. We're sorry. Lead us to the point where our lives may be in line with what you have taught. And you ask us to come before you as your children, to share with you that's on our hearts and minds, and to lift up our concerns and worries in this world. And so we lift up to you the leaders of this world, the leaders of our country, our state, our county, and the towns, municipalities, townships, boroughs in which we live. Lord, may the leaders lead in such a way that leads to unity rather than division, love rather than hatred. And that they lead in such a way that provides benefits and goodness for the people who are being led rather than for just those who are leading. I ask for your prayers. I ask your prayers for Christ's Holy Church, for our denomination, for our bishops, especially our Bishop Jeremiah Park, for our district superintendents, especially our district superintendent, Judy Walker, for all those who lead congregations, as well as those who attend worship, that together we may serve and minister as the body of Christ. I ask your prayers. Prayers for those who are sick, suffering, those who are in need of the Lord's healing touch, those who are recovering from various illnesses, surgeries, and physical difficulties. Pray that in the midst of where they are, they may feel the Lord's healing touch and spirit coursing through their bodies. Especially ask prayers for Jim Porcelis, Ruth Gossard, Bob Arnold, Dick Hartman, and Barb Green. I ask your prayers. I ask your prayers for those who are mourning this day, those who mourn the loss of loved ones to death, who mourn the loss of jobs, who mourn the loss of relationships, who mourn the loss of how their bodies used to function, who mourn the loss of what used to be considered normal and is now just a distant memory, or who mourn the loss of so many things that in this world are taken away. Pray that in the midst of their grief, they may find comfort and in their sorrow, and that they may grieve in such a way that they are brought back to the fullness of life. I ask your prayers. I ask your prayers for those who sacrifice themselves, who put their lives on the line so that others may be served, so that others may be healed, so that others may be protected. Be with them so that even in the midst of their service, pray that they may keep that attitude of service and that they may be kept safe. I ask your prayers. Now, as you desire, lift up your own prayers before our Lord this morning. Thank you, God, for hearing our prayers. Give the assurance of that hearing in each of our hearts, our souls, and our minds. Give us the ability to see you at work in our lives and the lives of others, and help us to be able to see, hear, and understand the answers to all of our prayers. Let us now join in praying in our hearts and in our minds the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples as a model for their prayers, a prayer that we've come to know of as the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today I'm going to change up the order of worship that you're used to just a little bit, and that I want to talk about our tithes and offerings first. Just as a reminder of all the offerings that we give to the Lord that we forget about. The prayers that you wrote in and put into the basket, the prayers that if any of you online ever put in the comments, those are an offering. We offer ourselves in worship, being here, or being online, taking an attitude in which we allow the Spirit to come into our lives, being open and receptive to what the Lord does in us. That's an offering. Being willing to serve as we can in ways that go beyond maybe which we are comfortable, but yet we know it needs to be done. That's an offering. Going to different Bible studies, reading devotionals, spending time on your own discipleship. That is an offering. We give so much, it goes beyond just what we think. But we also do give of what we have been given from the Lord. Because we believe everything that we have comes from Him. And so, therefore, we give to the congregation so that the mission and ministry of this congregation may continue. That we may continue to make disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world, both those who are here and those who are not yet here. And so I ask for your gifts to the Lord, that as you come in, you may give in the plate, you may give as you leave, but give as the Lord impresses upon your heart. And for those online, feel free to give by mailing in your checks or calling This morning I want to share with you a scripture that comes to us from the Hebrew scriptures. Now, this story that comes to us is from the book of Nehemiah, and I sort of want to set up some of the historical context for you and give you a little geographic lesson a little bit so you understand sort of what's happening around this time. Now, Nehemiah was a prophet. Now, this time happened when after the Israelites were taken from the kingdom of Judah and now exiled into Babylon. Now, Babylon is present-day Iraq, roughly. That's where they were. They were there for around 60 years. And then the king of Persia, which is now present-day Iran, took over Babylon and then was able to send all the people who were in captivity back if they so desired. Not everyone left. Some stayed in Babylon. And we know from later on in Nehemiah actually went to be with the king of Persia as his cupbearer. He was in a position of authority. And so we now hear these words of Nehemiah in the beginning of this book as he is starting to hear back from the stories from the people who have left Babylon and have gone back to Jerusalem and are now seeing what happened to those who were left behind and what they were encountering themselves. They told me those in the province who survived the captivity are in great trouble and shame. The wall around Jerusalem is broken down and its gates have been destroyed by fire. When I heard this news, I sat down and wept. I mourned for days, fasting and praying before the God of heaven. I said, Lord God of heaven, great and awesome God, you are the one who keeps covenant and is truly faithful to those who love you and keep your commandments. Let your ear be attentive and your eyes open to hear the prayer of your servant, which I now pray before you night and day for your servants, the people of Israel. I confess the sins of the people of Israel, which we have committed against you. Both I and my family have sinned. We have wronged you greatly and haven't kept the commandments, the statutes, and the ordinances that you commanded your servant Moses. Remember the word you gave to your servant Moses when you said, if you are unfaithful, I will scatter you among the people. But if you return to me and keep my commandments by really doing them, then even though your outcasts live under distant skies, I will gather them from there and bring them to the place that I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. They are your servants and your people. They are the ones whom you have redeemed by your great power and your strong hand. Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of your servant, and let the prayer of your servants who delight in honoring your name please
living it out.
We'll find as we go through this that this morality is one that is more dealt with looking inward than pointing outward. So we need to start with the definition of morality. And to do that, I forgot to change disciples to definition. So it's the definition of morality is a particular system of values and principles of conduct, especially one held by a specific person or society. Right? In other words, what are these values and what are these principles of conduct that define who we are? Now, if we are those of Christ, we end up taking that direction from our Lord. But at the same time, we take it from a whole lot of other things. We take it from society, we take it from our family, and we just need to know where it all comes from. When we look at Nehemiah, we start to see how this morality is actually lived out. I confess the sins of my people Israel, which we have committed against you. Both I and my family have sinned. We have wronged you greatly. We haven't kept the commandments, the statutes, the ordinances that you commanded your servant Moses. So their morality was one that was based in who they were. They were following the covenant of Moses that went through Abraham. That was their base of morality and how they defined how they should live their lives. This wasn't about all the other countries and all the other societies. This was about theirs. And that Nehemiah knew that it wasn't just he who had sinned, but it was everyone, because he is talking about how they were exiled, and he is caught in it, not because of anything he specifically did, but because of what had been done before him. And that we too are caught up always in the actions of others that have come before us. And we live in that era now, and we have to come to decide what it is we need to do and we need to follow. And so I would really summarize it by saying is that is asking, how do I live my life with integrity? How do I, as Jesus said, make my yes mean yes and my no mean no? How do I live what I say I need to live? That is integrity. So in the interest of integrity, I owe someone an apology. I owe Bill Fiore an apology. If you got that letter that went out from the council, I didn't realize I forgot his name. And he called me and he razzed me about it. But I truly am sorry. That the buck stops here. I forgot it. And yes, Joyce did proofread it, but I didn't have the names on it when she proofread it. It just said Clark Street Council, and then I filled in the names later. So I'm the one who forgot it. So Bill, please forgive us because we need you. Forgive me. That was my oversight. See, part of integrity is being willing to stand up and just say, yes, I did what I did. Not pushing the blame off on others, but it is focusing on our own actions. It's not getting defensive. It's not going, well, you know, there's a reason why. You know what? Own up. Just admit it. What did you do? What did you not do? We can't do anything unless we focus on our own actions. But if you are like me, it is so much easier to see what everybody else is doing wrong, is it not? Well, you know, look at that person, and look at that one, and look at this one over here. Oh my, can you believe what they're doing? You know, we can go on and on and on, pontificating about everybody else's problems and somehow making ourselves feel better because, well, at least we're not like fill in your favorite blank. But Jesus said this: first, take the log out of your eye. phrase that. Worry about yourself and don't worry about other people. You have a relationship with Christ. I'm sure there are things you are not doing. Once you get all of those perfectly set up, then worry about what everybody else does. Because there's something that happens. When we worry about other people, we take the focus off ourselves. If we are to live a moral life, and we are actually to worry about morality, it is not what everybody else is doing. What are each of us doing ourselves? Jesus had a way of constantly hitting on this subject because he would tell the people who knew better that they should know better. Don't worry about everyone else. You're the ones who know better, so do better. So he was talking to the religious experts and he said to them, in the same way, you look righteous to people, but inside you're full of pretense and rebellion. Can I rephrase that? Boy, you look sweet, but inside you're a mess. You look like your life's in order, but man, it's far from it. You hide all the dirt in the closet behind the curtains. Nobody sees what's really going on. But come on, admit it, you know. You're doing it because you want others to think that you are so great. You are holy. You're following the Lord. That you're being praised of the great follower you are. But you know, it's all a sham. It's all a show put on for others. What was he saying? Focus on yourself. Know yourself. Know your actions. Know your attitudes. Know what really comes from within inside and claim those as they are. Because when we claim those as we are, then we can start to confess our sins. It's a part of a two-part process. It doesn't stop there, but I'll just stop there for a moment. We need to confess our sins. How do we know what our sins are? The Lord tells us what our sins are. That's why it's this morality of taking the log out of our own eye. When we look at our own actions, it's amazing how the Lord can convict us. And the Spirit is a better convictor than any human being can be. The words in Greek I love because it gives us this metaphor for what sins are. The word in Greek for sins is the same word which means when an archer shoots at a target and misses. I think that really fits in the context of those who follow Christ. What it says is we confess that our actions do not line up with what we're aiming at. And we have to admit that they are not what we're aiming at. Because otherwise we rationalize them, right? Have you ever done that? Well, I know what it looked I was aiming at, but it actually hit where I really was trying to hit, right? The target's over there, and you hit the window. Well, that's because that's where I was really aiming. Yeah, come on. Right, admit to yourselves where they are. That way we can confess. Nehemiah said this. I confess the sins of the people of Israel, which we have committed against you. Both I and my family have sinned. When we are a part of a group, we are part of what a group does. So sometimes it's not just we ourselves who have sinned, but it is part of the society, the culture, the congregation that we have been a part of that have sinned. That we grow up in a sense of not necessarily looking deep and going, how have we missed the mark? That's a hard thing to do, because then sometimes we can get down on ourselves. But that's not the purpose of confession. The purpose of confession isn't
because it's really similar to the same thing. The reason why you turn around is you realize where you're headed was not where you wanted to go. So, how many of you have ever shot a bow, an arrow, or shot a gun, a pistol, or anything? Anyone here ever done that? Have you ever shot in such a way that you missed what you were aiming at? You don't know how many times I didn't hit the bullseye. So, what did you then just continue shooting where you first were aiming at? Well, if you had a sight, what did you do? You adjusted the sight. So that if you were off to the left, you said, okay, I'm going to move the sight so that it moves so that now I get where I'm aiming at. Or what we realize is that we have to change where we aim. If we have iron sights on a gun and we see that when we're aiming in the middle, we're up here, we then have to actually point down this way so that we hit where we want to hit. Or it's sort of like my golf game. See, I really hit the ball far off the driver. I'm about I used to be between 250 and 300 yard driver. There's a problem though. It went 50 yards straight. And the rest of the way, it maybe a 75, it took a severe right hand turn at 90 degrees or more, and would end up way over there in the trees. So if it went straight, it might have been 300 yards, but it wasn't even close. So if you ever were golfing with me and I wanted to aim and I wanted to hit the fairway, which is in front of me, I was standing over here. I was looking over almost where Pat is, and I hit the ball so that it would go where I wanted it to go. Kind of silly, but that's how it works. That's what it is when we confess and repent of our sin. Because we first acknowledge, hey, these are my actions. All right, guess what? I am not hitting where I'm aiming to go, so I better change something. Paul in Romans put it this way. So what are we going to say? Should we continue sinning so grace will multiply? Absolutely not. All of us died to sin. How can we still live in it? What he was saying is, yes, we all receive the grace of Christ. That when we are being forgiven, we receive grace. And the more we are forgiven, the more grace we receive. So therefore, does it really matter that we ever repent? Can't we just confess and keep on living the way we're living? Paul asked that as a rhetorical question, but he luckily gives us the answer. No. If we know who Christ is, then we know that sin died in us. So why would we want to continue doing what the Lord has told us that we should not do? And that's the question. He doesn't answer that. He allows each of us to answer that question. Are you willing not just to look at your own actions? Are you willing to admit that your actions sometimes do not hit the mark you are aiming at? And are you willing to change it and aim in a different way so that you get to where you're going? Starts with admitting, right? I am not being whom God is calling me to be. But it goes just beyond ourselves. If we are truly living a life with integrity and we are following the teachings of Christ, then we engage the injustices in the world that God shows each of us. Jesus told this to the religious leaders. Now, what the religious leaders did is they always wanted to make sure that they were following all the commandments and all the other rules that were listed within the Hebrew Scripture, which were about 635. So they had the commandments, and then they had other rules which sort of bordered the commandments, and then they were like, well, we've got to really make sure that we don't break these rules, so we're going to set up other rules to make sure not going to get out of the sidewalk. Even though there is grass between the sidewalk and the street, if I don't get on the grass, then I know I won't get on the sidewalk. That's the logic. So Jesus said this to them: you give to God a tenth of mint, dill, and cumin, but you forget about the most important parts of most important matters of the law: justice, peace, and faith. You want to give a tenth, but without forgetting about the more important matters. See, they were required by the law of Moses to be able to give to the temple a tenth of meat, of fat, of grain, of fruit. But they decided, well, if that's good enough, we should also give the spices that would go along with those things. And Jesus said, you know what, you're doing a great job. You should be that generous. But you shouldn't say, then that's enough. You're forgetting what's really important. And that is justice, peace, and faith. The scriptures are always filled with God saying that he stands up for those who are facing injustices, for those who are neglected, for the widow, for the orphan, for the stranger, for the foreigner, for those who are cast out. God's heart is with them and seeks justice for those who society does not give justice to. But we can only engage in the injustices that God shows us, because otherwise we are not really doing what we need to do. We need to be open for God to show us, hey, this is what you need to do. This is what you need to work to change. This is what you need to seek to address. Just as in sins, I will list your sins and tell you what they are. I'll let the Lord deal with them with you. So it is with the injustices. I'm not about to list the injustices of people or things or whatever. I'll let the Lord bring them up in your own heart. He will convict you far more than I ever will. So what can we do? What can we do not to be more generous? I didn't change that either. Boy, I really have a whole lot of integrity to go over, don't I, today? That shouldn't be to be more generous. That should actually be to live my life with more integrity. Well, at least you know I'm not perfect. So what can we do? Well, one thing you might be able to do is maybe you are good at focusing on everybody else's life and finding out that everybody else is wrong. Well, you know, maybe it's time to look in the mirror and start focusing on yourself and the Lord. Maybe you need to pray to God to convict you of your sin and repent. Because when I say to you, you need to repent of your sin, your mind goes, no, I can't think of any. Maybe you need to sit some time with God and say, God, I know I have things that you want me to change. Come on. I want to be who you want me to be. Maybe you need to pray for strength to fight against injustice that God shows you. Because whenever you stand up for injustice, it's hard because you're going to make waves and people are going to like you and some people are going to disagree with you and they're going to say, well, that's not really an injustice. Well, you need to stand up for what God is telling you to stand up for. And I'm going to tell you one thing that's true, that as a body of Christ, we will never agree on all the injustices. Some of us will say one thing's an injustice, another one will say, well, absolutely it is not. But what's important is that you're living a life of integrity. And that as you see an injustice, as the Lord shows it to you, you stand up for it in a way in which you are compassionate, you are loving, you are caring, you are respectful, but yet still standing up. Or maybe there is something else which the Lord has brought to your mind that you need right now to be doing. So I'm going to pray in the first person because I know what the Lord has done in and through my own heart and not yours. So if these words resonate with you, I ask you to close your eyes and bow your heads in prayer as we pray together.
Gracious Lord, I have to admit to you that I am not always the best at seeing how I have done wrong. It's so easy for me to see everybody else's faults, everybody else's failures, to want other people to be different, to act different, to have different opinions. The list goes on and on. But Lord, truly, the only person I can control is me. The only one that I have control over in terms of living a life of integrity is myself. The only one who I can actually change is me. So help me, Lord, to look at my own actions in light of my Lord Jesus Christ. Help me not to look at them in the light of what others have said, what others have taught, what I have known so far, what I hear in the news, what I read online, or all the other sources that come in to tell me how I should be living my life and how I should see the world. Help me, Lord, rather to come before you with the teachings of Christ before me, so that I may truly live a life that has the teachings of Christ at its core. Help me then to confess where I have not done what I should have done, and when I have done what I should not have done. Help me to confess when I have not loved others as I was supposed to have loved myself. Help me to forgive others just as you have forgiven me. Help me to then change, to live a life so that it is in line with the teachings of my Lord. Help me truly to live in such a way that I can reflect the image of my Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And it's in his name that I truly pray. Amen. The last song that is going to be sung is Sanctuary. It's a song that it looks like some of the verses did not make it through when I... No, it looks better over there than on my screen. Most of you may know it from just the chorus, but there are some verses that we're going to go along with as well. What happens is when we're doing this, it is a song for ourselves because we are asking the Lord to prepare us to be a sanctuary from which the Holy Spirit dwells. For when the Spirit comes and lives within inside of us, we are changed from the inside out. This is how the Lord goes, because the Lord knows our weakness and is able to give us strength. The Lord leads us so that we are free from temptation, and then we are purified from within. So let, as we listen to this song, truly allow the Lord to prepare us to be a sanctuary to house the presence of the Holy Spirit that comes to us through our Lord Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
and that the love of Christ, which you aim to show, truly comes and pours out of your heart. So may the grace of God, the peace of Jesus Christ, and the transforming power of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.
Yeah, right.